Are we ready?
Okay.
Hi everyone, this is Mario from the Camp Gallery with Jenny Perez. We're a little bit late because we were setting everything up appropriately, but this is the Q&A session here at Miami Botanical Gardens.
How's it been? I'm doing great. Thank you guys all for being here.
For context, so you guys know, this is an exhibition that's on until February 27th. It's in collaboration directly with Jenny and the garden in their private room. Do you want to maybe, Maria, show real quick like a 360? But with that, I think we're gonna get started. Does that sound okay?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, my first question, which we talked a little bit about just the other day, was about how you had mentioned that you feel like you've been in open dialogue with the city throughout your entire career, which that was a really cool idea given the fact that there's so many landmarks throughout the city that do have proof of that, like evidence of that you can see afterwards. How significant do you think the city of Miami has been in that dialogue and your growth as an artist? And then this is a three-pronged question, so I'll bring the other two after the next of the first one, so you don't lose your train of thought.
I mean, when I started painting, I was quite young, mm-hmm. and I was going out a lot and wanting to experience Miami as a young adult. And I found myself going to Little Havana and listening to like music and going to different bars. Obviously, you're 22 years old, you're 20, you're whatever, and you're just sitting at a bar and you find yourself drawing. And so a lot of the times, the paintings were, not studies, but they were derived of these drawings that I had done outside in Miami, partying and hanging out, listening to music. And so the first few years of the work is you'll see lots of references to trumpets and drummers and music. DJ LaSpam is here with us tonight, who I spent many nights with him and his band. And so the city of Miami really spoke to me, the colors, everything about it. And so, yeah, the first drawing I ever did was of Ocean Drive. People were relating in their short shorts and topless. So, I mean, yeah, the city is speaks to me.
I love that mention that you made of like experiencing Miami as a young adult, because I think a lot of local Miamians can relate to the feeling of like finding a new city in your adulthood.
Yeah.
The city really changes
yeah.
as you come into your own. But like you mentioned, oh, go ahead.
No, I'm sorry. You said something that really spoke to me too, because some people in Miami and what's happening with Miami is that it used to be very cliche. And it used to be very like Boston. Like, what represents Miami? Pineapples and, you know, fruit, beach, palm trees, lots of sun. And so being an artist throughout those years where Miami started to come into its own, because we were both adolescents, you know, I was living as an adolescent, Miami was quite young as well. To sort of be a part of that conversation as Miami changes is also really, has been quite interesting for me.
I think the city's changed as well in the sense that it's become more of a city in proper rather than like
location
spot. Exactly. So it's funny how like that happens as you're coming to age as well.
Yeah.
But I think you already made reference to this, but how do you see that relationship changing moving forward? Because you've already talked about how it's evolved over time, but do you see any sort of continuance of that?
I think it's a conversation that you have to have with the locals, especially the older generation. I get calls to do murals and public art that is very, like I said, old Miami and very cliche. So it's about giving people what they want, but also giving them a new, like, face, a shift into what the city really is molding into.
Yeah.
And so I think it's just about having those, like, hard conversations or telling people I'm not going to do a pineapple. I'm not gonna do, but I know that you want to do something that's so derivative of Miami and inspired by Miami. And it's so easy to be Miami and Miami all the time, but it's not easy to say, let's shift the narrative and let's talk about all the other things that make Miami Miami.
Yeah, and at the end of the day, you maintain your like artistic integrity.
Absolutely.
In that.
Yeah.
Do you ever see yourself, because we've been talking about Miami and how this is like where you're based out of and how so much of your work is tied to that. Do you ever see yourself branching out of there, either as an artist or just in your life in general?
Yeah, absolutely. I think some of the strongest work I've ever created has been outside of Miami. I've been to Italy and I've been to New Orleans on two different residencies, and those were the cities that really kicked my ass, but also I was able to step outside of the typical color palette that I find easy to work with in the city, in Miami specifically. And so I think it's important for me specifically, I don't know about other artists, but for me specifically, to create space outside of the city. So living elsewhere for a short amount of time really does wonders for me and my work.
Definitely.
Yeah.
I think, I mean, you already know that I love your series. It's like the first thing that attracted me to your work. So that series is beautiful. And if that speaks to what your work could look like in the future, should you continue to do residencies and stuff like that, I think that's really exciting.
Awesome, thank you.
So another thing that really struck me when we were trying to, you know, discuss what your work meant and what some of the defining themes were, was the fact that your career as an artist making work on canvases and your career as a street artist kind of came hand in hand, which is very atypical for someone who does street art.
Yeah.
And how you felt like a lot of your work at first had like its roots in like performance space work, almost, because people would watch you do mural or you even do canvases live.
Yeah.
How do you think the viewer in those situations like influences the work you make, if at all? Do you think they kind of just do so in like a big energizing type of way, or do you think they inform what you're actually making?
When I'm painting live, I tune out the people, but without them, I don't paint as good. So it's an interesting conversation that I have with them, because it is a dialogue, but I'm not directly interacting with them. And so when there's a lot of people, I feel like the performance is a little bit more exaggerated, it's a little bit more expressive. I paint faster, I create pieces that are a lot bolder when there's a lot of people. And I step outside of my comfort zone because I feel this urge to sort of get their attention.
Yeah.
And so it is a conversation, but it's not a direct conversation. So if I paint live and there's three people in the room, I'm gonna sit around, I'm not gonna be really engaged in peace. So the more people the better for me. And then street art is always interesting because I like to talk to everybody that walks by or that wants to talk to me. And sometimes people move you in the most unexpected ways. I remember the last mural I did in Wynwood, I had a 45-minute conversation with a homeless man. And it was really moving, and I cried, and it was just so nice. And I remember what it was like to paint on the street, because usually there's like a rope, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And there's this separation between myself and the audience. So when I'm painting on the street, there is no separation. It's just like anybody can come up to you and of any kind of walk of life from anywhere in the world. So that's really cool.
I see. So it's like, it's almost like one extreme or the other. It's like either out of sight, out of like just not paying attention to them.
Yeah.
Or it's like they really heavily.
Yeah. And half the time they're not even paying attention to me. I find that when I'm being hired to do like performances, whether it be at a setting like the Wynwood Walls or a hotel or an Art Basel party, everybody is sort of hanging out, drinking, doing their own thing. And I'm part of the background. Part of the ambiance, right? But it still fuels me, you know? But when you're painting on the street, it's like every single person that's walking by or every car that's driving by, they're honking, they're there, they're having that conversation with you as it's happening. They're not distracted, you know?
There's more presence.
it's like a little bit more presence, yeah, versus like if I'm at a party, you know, which is also fun, but it comes with a different set of interaction, I guess you could say.
I mean, I also think like what you mentioned about knowing that you're being watched, so wanting to step up is like such a relatable feeling. I think everyone has that moment at some point in time in their life where they're like, people are watching me, I'm gonna do what I can do.
Absolutely.
And show them what's up.
Yeah.
I like what you were mentioning earlier about like kind of the nostalgia almost about your 20s and how they came along with the start of your career. And we talked also about like you feel that your work almost captures your feelings at a specific point in time in your life. And so my question for you is, how do you feel that these pieces capture those emotions? And how does like the creation of these works relate to like the reason why you wanted to become an artist? If you get what I'm saying.
I think it's all connected. Mm-hmm. You know, there is something I must admit, and the truth is, when I work, I don't know what I'm working on until afterwards.
Mm-hmm.
So the work sort of tells me versus me telling it. So that's one thing about me that I don't really share with a lot of people. I'm not the kind of artist that does sketches and knows exactly what I'm going to create. And so there's that aspect to it, right? There's a certain vulnerability and a certain level of spontaneity and surrender that happens through the process, and so for me it's about having that ability and that will to want to create something and then see what happens without having an attachment to anything, you know. But yeah, that's I hope I answered that question.
Yeah, cool. I don't know if you remember, but the night that this show opened, someone came up to you.
Okay.
I don't remember who it was. I also didn't know them at the time, so I read them. And they said, oh, you have a painting of a dog here, right? And we were
yeah,
like,
no. Out.
She was like, no dogs. But then at the same time, when we last spoke, you were kind of talking about how you try to deconstruct figurative images in order to kind of to democratize them so other people can see them and experience them on their own as well. So how do you, I guess my question is like, how do you manage the fact that obviously because this is your artwork and you're an artist, like you feel precious about your work, but also the fact that you're trying to make it so that people can consume it and interpret what they can.
So that specific comment brought up a lot of old narratives that I'm trying to free myself from, the dog comment in specific, because I used to work for a painter, so I didn't go to school, but I apprenticed for many years under an artist. His thing was dogs, painting dogs all the time. And so for me, it was like, as soon as I stopped working for him, I made this conscious effort to never be like that person, you know? Like, he taught me everything. It's like good parenting. Like, sometimes, like, they're disasters, and it's kind of good because you know, like,
what not to do.
And so that was my time spent there, was taking notes on all the things I didn't want to do or create, and he fell into commission-based work that was very much about painting people's dogs. And so it just felt really crippling. And so when that person said dog, I immediately was like, oh, no, never. But I have people tell me things all the time, like, oh, this painting, I see like a ship, and I see a horizon, and I see a demon, whatever, and it's like, I'm fine with it, you know? It's just that specific comment sort of struck me in a way, you know? But I'm not attached to the work in that sense. I want people to be able to take away what they need to take away from the work. It's abstract for a reason.
Yeah, I would say your work kind of borders on abstract and figurative, though. Like, it kind of teeters on the line. There are some pieces that when you first look at them, they're abstract, and then you look more and you're like, wait, there's a face there.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's a very clear face there. Yeah. It's not.
I'm trying not to be so manipulative. I think sometimes that work can be very restricting for me,
mm-hmm.
and quite boring. So I just try to do everything that doesn't bore me.
Yeah.
So, that's why. Yeah.
That's such a cool story.
That sounds like no. No.
I would have never known. Now that you have some years of experience behind you and you know, a pretty full resume in terms of collaborations with other people, what are the things that you're looking for as you enter like into this next step? And what's like, what would you like to achieve as an artist?
I just want to keep creating work that, I just want to keep creating work. I want to keep creating work that is so me, and I think the last 10 years of the work that I've been doing has been trying to find myself. And I think I'm at a point now where I'm starting to really see myself in the work, and that's exciting. So I kind of want to go a little bit deeper, and I think that's the whole point. Everything else is just bells and whistles, and it becomes quite fun when you start playing with other people. But for me, the necessity and the desire is simply to just keep creating work that is powerful and that speaks to me and that I feel good about.
Like you mentioned earlier, you are a self-taught artist, and what we've seen, like in general, in the art industry at least, is that self-taught artists have really risen in popularity.
Yeah.
Especially within the collective space, gallery space, so on and so forth. Obviously, you don't have a unique perspective on this sort of discussion because you are a self-taught artist, but you don't have a monopoly, so you don't have to come up with like a super complicated answer. But why do you think that is, and what do you think has led to that progression towards self-taught artists?
I think simply because people are seeking or wanting art that is vulnerable and that is lacks certain restrictions and borders. And so we're in a place and a time collectively that we're sort of like creating that, right? That connectivity to human nature and what it means to be a human and the language that humans speak. And sometimes when you get caught up in education or institutional art, it becomes so like boxed in, it becomes so confined and feels restricted in so many ways because the artist is so consumed with everything that they've learned and all the do nots, all the don'ts. And sometimes, and I remember being the odd one when I was painting around all of my friends that were art students, that went to grad, that went to New World, that had degrees and tons of degrees on art, and they were doing a 45-minute line, and I would be like 16 paintings deep, you know, just having a good time, dancing away, and they would look at me and say, I envy you. And then I would look at them and say, well, can you teach me why that line is taking you 45 minutes? And so we would both like learn from each other, and I think that's important too. You know, I'm not saying diminish education completely. I think it's important, but there is a certain level of spontaneity that comes from not knowing. You know, not knowing that you're making mistakes and learning as you make them. To say, oh, that doesn't look good, and it's like, oh, it's because the composition's off, or you know, you're not supposed to mix those colors together. You know, so.
Yeah, I agree. I think to your point, I think it just really depends on the individual person.
Yeah.
Like, people's lives take them in different directions. Some people go towards getting a formal education, other people don't. But one thing that I've noticed among self-taught artists that I've seen is that, like you, they take steps that, like, I think someone that's been formally trained wouldn't take because you're told early on, like, oh, like you mentioned specifically, those two materials don't go together. Like, for example, you don't draw on a canvas.
Absolutely.
At the end of a painting. You don't put graphite over wet paint.
Right.
Things like that. And you're not limited by those types of things because no one was there to like chastise you when you decided to do those types of things. Mm-hmm. So I think that's such a valid point. I think it also reflects a continued democratization of being an artist. At one point in time, you had to... The only great artists were the artists that went to Europe for training. And then it was the ones that went to training, period. And now it's anyone who has that mindset and has the, you know, the talent.
Yeah. Has something to say.
Yeah.
Whenever I meet young artists, they're so consumed with, you know, just trying to figure it out. Figure it out. And it's like, you know, the best advice I can give the young artists is to just work and to create a disciplined studio practice and just experiment and work and to tune out all of the other stuff, you know?
Yeah.
And to understand who you are, because I think when you look at a painting, especially me, I can see a painting of mine, I can actually understand myself more, I can see myself in the work, and once you can see yourself, I think then you've achieved something, you know? So it's just about putting in the hours.
Of course. So the last question we have, and then we're going to go to the questions that anyone might have online or in the room, is you post a lot about also being a yogi and a yoga instructor. Do you think there's any overlap between that and your work as an artist?
For sure. I mean, so for me, yoga is a completely energetic practice, and so is painting, and so it kind of goes hand in hand. It's just one is good for the body, and then one is good for the soul. And actually, yoga is good for both. You know, painting is not so good for the body. It has actually screwed me up a lot. But I think they go hand in hand. There's a fluidity that comes with yoga that I find quite compares to the fluidity in the work that I do and how I paint. You know?
Yeah.
So I'm so happy I got yoga. It keeps me sane.
With that, I think we're nearly finished unless there's
would you want to speak to any goals that you have, like any residencies or like big things and why?
Yes, so thank you for asking. So my biggest insecurity was not having an education, so I think, and I talked to you about this endlessly, just stepping a little bit more into the arts from a more institutional stance, a more like applying to the residencies, researching the residencies, going to different shows and working with galleries, because I've always been sort of like the one that represented myself my entire career as a street kid and just figuring it out as I go. And it's a quite lonely road. And so I think now the goal is to embrace the art world in a way that I never have before, because I've always been like, oh my gosh, the art kids are so snobby. And it's like, no, they're not snobby. If you just talk to them, it's just you're just shutting them out because you're the one that is insecure, you know what I mean? So I think I'm finally okay with saying, yes, I'm self-taught, but I have something to contribute to, and let's talk, you know? So that's the goal.
We actually do have one question here from Instagram, which is, did I just say Instagram? From the Instagram
live. From the Instagram.
Which is, do you have any advice for an up-and-coming artist on how to connect with people and for your career?
Yeah, so your art is a direct connection to who you are. And so the more you show, the more you connect to people. And it's really quite simple. When I first started, I was showing outside of Whole Foods in the parking lot. Like, I did everything. I showed in sex shops, nightclubs, coffee shops. But each experience, no experience was, I was never too good for any experience or any place. And each time I did it, I met somebody. And that person connected me to someone else. And that person connected me to someone else. And before you know it, I had collectors. I was doing projects. And so I think as an artist, it's just important to, yes, work, but allow yourself to get exposed. You know, just be okay with showing and knocking on people's doors and saying, put this painting up and see how people respond to it.
Yeah, to that point, I think one thing that I've noticed in you very well is that you know how to be a host and you know how to be sociable and affable to where people want to talk to you and they want to talk about your work, and you put, like, you have a good capacity for like outreach in a way that I think a lot of artists don't. And I almost feel like it's unfair to a typical artist, maybe there's no such thing as a typical artist, but it would be unfair to someone to say, you know, turn it on for the crowd. Because I think a lot of artists typically are not that personality type.
Yeah.
But I would say, Jenny is a case study for if you have the capacity to do that, like, take advantage of it.
I'll add to that. So one thing that I didn't do, there was a point in time in my life for a good 3 years my early 20s. And like I said, I was going out a lot. So I brought my sketchbook with me everywhere. Everywhere. I would be the girl in the heels or in the docks and like looking cool at the bar with my sketchbook. And it was such an interesting experiment or study because I allowed myself to be the artist all the time, no matter where I was. And so that sort of created the comfort and the, I'm just used to talking about it all the time. I would be at the bar and if like somebody would come and talk to me, they'd be like, what are you drawing? And then that would create a conversation. And it's like, oh, Jenny is the artist girl. And so I was always the artist, no matter where I was. I was never, oh, this girl. It's like, oh, there's that girl, she's drawing in the cut, you know? And I got that advice from one of the artists that I like, really admire. And he told me, he's like, you need to bring your sketchbook with you everywhere and you need to have at least 15 drawings a day. You know, he was quite intense, but I did that when I was really young and I still do it sometimes too.
I have a question.
Is there another question?
So Danny wants to know what inspires the colors Jenny uses and what artists influence the color. Or maybe, I think they mean to say
influence
like,
work in general.
Yeah, but as far as your color palette is concerned.
Color is for me mood. And so for like a good 2 years, I was obsessed with pink. So everything was pink. I thought pink was actually quite neutral in terms of being both masculine and feminine. And I found that blue was a little bit too generic and purple was too fluff. So I was like, pink is masculine and it's feminine, it's sharp, it's bold. But now I hate pink. You know, it's like, you kind of have to go with what you're feeling. And additionally, I don't do color studies ever. So what I do is I go and buy colors that speak to me or whatever colors are available. And then I have them sort of laid out. So when I start painting, if I'm working on something and I see that green that I bought 3 months ago, I'll probably pick it up and see how it feels when I put it on canvas. So I never really have like a set color palette. It's always about just what colors are in my studio at the time. Except for the pink. The pink was something that I just kept using for a while.
Do you want to talk about artists that have influenced you?
Yeah, you know, I always have this, you know the term FOMO, fear of missing out. So I have this FOMO of like New York in the 1980s and I obsess over, like documentaries, like Graffiti Kids and Keith Haring, Basquiat, Madonna, like that whole era. And I think for me, when I discovered that art is when I really was like, that's cool. Like, I want to do that. But growing up in Miami, I didn't have much to reference. I had, you know, quite literally two artists. I think it was Romero Brito and David Lebo. And those were the two guys that I admired and I loved because they were in the 1990s and they did happy art and that was the art that I saw. And so when I discovered New York art, those artists, Basquiat, Keith Haring, Andy Warhol, those were Picasso, of course, but those artists were the ones that really just wanted to embody their lifestyle, the thing that they stood for.
Do we have any other
Awesome.
Well, then in that case, that's the end of the Instagram Live portion. Again, the show's available through Jenny